First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation. And today I will speak about my joint work with Sasha Bufetov, which is in progress. In general, it's devoted to some dynamical properties of determinantial random point processes. And more precisely, we will speak about the behavior of trajectories of the sign process. And despite that, Jan Shi has already spoke about determinantial processes. Let me, however, recall some basic definitions. But I'll do this in a very informal way. Okay, sorry. So, definitions. And they will not be rigorous. Random point process, determinantial random point processes is a special class of random point processes. So, let me first define the random point processes in general. To this end, let me take some phase space. Let it be just the real line. If you want, you can consider Rn, but it will be just the same. For simplicity, I take determinantial random point processes on the real line. And let us just take some particles and let drop them randomly at this line in such a way that first each throw, the number of particles by this sign, I will denote the number of particles, is less or equal than countable. And second, for any Borel set of the real line, the number of particles which hits this set is finite. So you have some bounded set. Here you can have only finite number of particles. And this construction is called the random point process. In order to define it rigorously, you need to take the space. Space is a space of locally finite configurations on R. You need to take some sigma algebra. Sigma algebra is just a sigma algebra generated by random variables of this type. And then you just take some probability measure on this space and this sigma algebra, and the triple, the space, the sigma algebra, and the measure is called random point process. Usually, let us assume that there exist the correlation functions. The correlation functions is a family of functions rho n, where n is entire and more than or equal to 1. The function rho n is a function from Rn, so it's a function of n variables to R plus, such that for any points x1, xn from R, which are disjoint, we have the following simple relation. So the probability that in infinitely small neighborhoods of each of points x1 and so on, xn, you have exactly one particle equals to rho n of x1 and so on xn dx1 dxn. So somehow the correlation function can be seen as a probability density if you are interested in only fixed number of particles and you aren't interested in the other particles. And usually in applications such functions exist. Let me mention the simplest example of random point process. This is a Poisson process. This is a random point process because you consider the points of increase of this process as a particles which you drop on the real line. And then the correlation functions, they are just constant and they equal to lambda to the power n, where lambda is a parameter of the Poissonian process. Okay, now definition. A random point process is called determinantial if there exists the function k of two variables, which is called the correlation kernel or just the kernel, such that we have that the correlation functions have the following determinantial form. So it's a determinant of the following matrix, k of x1, x1, and so on, k of x1, xn, k of xn, x1, and so on, k of xn, xn. And it should be true for any n. So from the first point of view, the determinantial processes is something extremely special, because I mean you take the correlation functions of some very, very special form, but it turns out that they appear naturally in many areas of mathematical physics and mathematics. In particular, they play the crucial role in the random matrix theory, they play an important role in the representation theory and statistical mechanics, and in quantum mechanics also. And one of the most known representatives of determinantial processes is the sine process, which is given by the following correlation, which have the following simple form. So k of xy equals to sine of x minus y over pi x minus y. And Yanxi have already defined, in fact, the sine kernel, but here he had something like p times alpha. It's just a question of normalization. It's basically the same object. Okay, unfortunately, I have no time to explain you, to give you a detailed example of where the sine process arises, but let me, however, say a couple of words about this. Let us consider a large random matrix with independent entires, which are Gaussian, and in such a way that the matrix is Hermitian. And then if you calculate the eigenvalues of this matrix, since the matrix is Hermitian, they are real, and then you study what happens when the size of the matrix goes to infinity, it turns out that the eigenvalues under some proper normalization are governed exactly by the sine process. And moreover, so it means that the particles which you drop on the real line under the sine process can be considered just as the eigenvalues of such an infinite random matrix under proper normalization. And moreover, it turns out that this holds not only for such a random matrix that I described, but it holds for a large class of random matrices, and you always get the sine process, like a universal limit. In particular, it's interesting because it was first developed by physicists, because such eigenvalues of such random matrices described well behavior of energy levels in some quantum systems. Okay, so I hope that you will believe me that random point processes and in particular the sine process worth studying. So let me turn to the subject of my talk, I mean almost to the subject of my talk now, the central limit theorem. Let us consider the sine process. And further on, I will talk only about the sine process. Here we have our real line and our particles. And let us consider a time interval, not time interval, but just the interval 0n. And let us find the number of particles which hits the interval 0n. And let us look what happens when n goes to infinity. What is the behavior of this random variable? Clearly it increases, but the question is how? And the answer to this question was given by the famous physicists Kostin and Leibovitz in 1995. So they showed that this behavior is governed by the central limit theorem, just in the usual setting of the central limit theorem. More precisely, they considered the following random variable xi n, which equals to the number of particles hitting the interval 0 n minus its expectation, just as usual in a central limit theorem, and over the square root of the variation of this number of particles. And then it turns out that this random variable in distribution converges weakly when n goes to infinity to a standard Gaussian random variable. Psi is standard Gaussian. However, the situation here turns out to be in fact very unusual because of the following. If you calculate the variation of the number of particles hitting the interval 0, n, you will find that it behaves as a logarithm of n as n goes to infinity. So the variation grows really slowly, because usually in the central limit theorem you have a linear growth of the variation. And if you calculate the expectation of this number of particles, you will get just a usual linear growth as in classical central limit theorem. So it just equals to n. Yeah. N over. Yeah, I have pi here. I think that it's okay. My intensity up. Wait.
Pi in sine pi of x
minus one. Yes, sorry. Yes, I should think that. Yes, sorry. Should be correct. Yes. Okay. Well, and it's well known that for classical systems where the central limit theorem holds, we also have the functional central limit theorem, or the Donsker invariance principle, what is the same. Roughly speaking, it says the following. If a random variable is governed at infinity by the central limit theorem, then its trajectories are governed by the Brownian motion. And however, for determinational processes, nothing is known about behavior of their trajectories, and even for the sine process. So the question we pose is actually, can we prove something as a functional central limit theorem if we have the Brownian motion under the limit, and if not, then what do we have? A standard way to speak about the functional central limit theorem is the following. We need to consider the following random process. So we need to take the random variable from the central limit theorem and to insert the time here. So t is time now. By the following way, so I put the time to the numerator and I do not touch the denominator. However, here I will replace this variance by the 1 over p squared logarithm of n, because it just asymptotically is the same. And I consider time interval from 0 to 1. And look, if I study this process in the space of trajectories when time goes from 0 to 1, I will cover exactly all my interval 0, n. So indeed, I study this random variable in the space of trajectories. So the question we pose is, what is the behavior of the distribution of this process as n goes to infinity? And here I put dot, I mean that I consider the trajectories. I work in the space of trajectories, not for fixed time. And in the classical setting, you have just here the convergence to the Brownian motion. But it turns out that in our situation, nothing as Brownian motion appears. We find something which resembles more the white noise. And let me state our main result. which describes this behavior. Yeah. In the denominator? No, I do not put, because I mean it doesn't make sense. Look, if I put t here, then what happens? Then I can say that, say, tn will be m, I'll get just the central limit theorem. The point is that when t changes from 0 to n, I study exactly the trajectories. Here? Ah, FCLT, sorry, functional central limit theorem.
No.
Ah, excuse me, 0 tn. Yeah, sorry. 0 tn. So it's basically the same as here, but inserted time there. Yeah. Okay. So our main result is the following theorem, which states that there exists random variable eta n, and which is real, and a random process ztn such that the following holds. First, the integral of our process from 0 to t, so xi s n ds equals to t times eta n plus ztn over square root of the logarithm of n. It holds for all times. So till the moment I say the following, I say that the integral of our process, so I study not the process itself, I study its integral. Why? Because it turns out that the process is very regular, it behaves, it resembles more the white noise than the Brownian motion, so standard way to treat the white noise is just to take time integral of it and you'll get the Brownian motion. So it's reasonable here to take the time integral. And we state that it grows just linearly in time. And then you have also some reminder. And about these processes, this random variable eta n and the process ztn, we can say the following, that their joint distribution converges weakly when n goes to infinity to the joint distribution of a random variable eta and a process zt in the space of real numbers, which is responsible to eta, and times the space of continuous functions, which is responsible to our process z, where eta is just a centered Gaussian random variable with the variance 1/2, and that t is a centered Gaussian process with the following covariance, since this is centered, the covariance is just expectation of the product. The covariance is rather awful, but I mean the precise formula is not too important. What is important is that we can find it explicitly. S minus 1 theta of t, I will say in a moment what is theta, plus t minus 1 theta of s minus t theta of s minus 1 minus s theta of t minus 1, where theta of t is just t squared logarithm of the absolute value of t. And moreover, the random variable eta and the process that t are independent. And the third item of our theorem said something about the convergence of eta n to eta, And more precisely, it says that the rate of convergence d of eta n to the distribution of eta is less or equal than 1 over square root of the logarithm of n. So this is our result. And now let me try to explain what does it mean. To this end, I will draw some picture. So here we have time, and here we have our process. Process, I mean the integral from 0 to t of xi sn ds. And we have the real line, t times eta, where eta is just a random Gaussian random variable with these parameters. And we know that our process is governed by another line, another straight line, t times eta n, which converges in distribution to this straight line with the rate 1 over square root of the logarithm of n. So in some sense, this distance is of order 1 over square root of logarithm of n. And then we have also this remainder, which is of the same order that this deviation. But about the remainder, we know up to higher order terms everything. So we know that this is just a centered Gaussian process with the given covariance. So here we have some Gaussian oscillations around this straight line. So this is basically the behavior of our process. So as you see, nothing as Brownian motion appears. However, we have something different. And now, if you do not have questions till the moment, I will turn to, first I would like to explain how one can arrive to such a statement, how I can understand that you need to consider the time integral of our process and not the process itself, and so on. And then I will pass to the proof of the theorem. So if there are some questions till the moment. Yeah. Sorry? The explanation? Ah, okay. Basically, it means the following. It means that the particles under the sign process, they are distributed on your real line in a very regular way, because you have some repulsiveness of particles under the sign process, and that's why the variation can grow only very slowly. But I mean the rigorous explanation is some calculation. The calculation? Ah, okay. I mean it uses the following. Basically, you just calculate the variation by the definition. You have some L2 product there. I mean, you can represent your integrals as a L2 product. Then you use the Parseval identity and you use that the Fourier transform of this function. If you consider it as a function of one variable x minus y, this is just the indicator function of the interval 0, 1. Yeah, and basically that's it. Okay, maybe I'll explain it better after the talk because it's really some rather tedious calculation. Okay. Other examples of determinational process. Yeah, it isn't the science about only one process. In a similar way, you can also get so-called. I mean, the similar way if you consider large limit of random matrices when the size goes to infinity. If you choose some definite normalization, you also get some different processes, so-called Airy process, Bessel process. But let me not enter into details because their kernels have much more complicated forms. So unfortunately, I have no time to explain it. But it isn't a science about only one process. I mean, there is some class of interesting processes. If I take just arbitrary K about all this, I mean, here, what do I really need? I need the logarithmic growth of the Airy process, the Bessel process. But for the part of my results which I will mention later, I need exactly that the kernel has such form, but I think that probably it's technically. I mean, just for the moment, I can do this only for the same process, but probably for the Bessel and Airy, it's also possible, and I think so. But yeah, for a moment, you have the result only for the same process. Okay, so now let me try to explain how one can arrive to such statement of the theorem. And to this end, let us forget for the moment about this theorem. Let us just remember that we have such a random process and we want to study the behavior of its trajectories when n goes to infinity. The first thing that we should do, we want to understand what can be the limiting process. What can be the limit? To this end, you argue in a standard way, and what you need to do just to find the behavior of finite dimensional distributions of your process. You have the following lemma, which states that for any times t1, which is more than or equal to 0, and so on, td, for some natural number d, which is less or equal than 1, we have that the finite dimensional distributions of our process converge when n goes to infinity weakly to the following random vector psi t1 and so on psi td, where the vector psi t1 psi td is a centered Gaussian. The centered Gaussian with the following covariance, expectation of psi ti psi tj equals to 1/2 if t is equal to s and 0 if t is different from s. So you see the limiting covariance is independent from the choice of our times. So in particular, it means if you take one time very close to another, then nothing changes. It means that under the limit, you cannot have a continuous process in principle. So nothing is Brownian motion is possible. I will prove this lemma. Let me, however, say just a couple of words about this. To prove the convergence itself, it's rather straightforward generalization of the Kostin-Leibovitz central limit theorem for the multidimensional setting. And to see that the variance has such form, this rather simple computation, you need to just to calculate the variance before the limit and then take the limit. And here you crucially use that the variance has the logarithmic growth. And in this proposition, I use only I do not use that I consider the sine process. I use only the logarithmic growth of the variation. What is remarkable for the Kostin-Leibovitz theorem? In fact, you do not need this logarithmic growth. You need only that the variation just grows to infinity. And in our setting, we indeed need it. So the behavior of trajectories really depends on this logarithmic growth of the variation. Well, now let us try to understand better what is this limiting distribution. To this end, I note that it can be represented as a distribution of the sum of two random vectors. The first of them has the same random variable at each component, And the second one is gamma t1, gamma t d. And here the random variable eta, gamma t1, gamma td, have the same normal distribution with parameter 0, 1 half, and they are mutually independent. So it means the following. This is just a simple computation, because, I mean, if you take the sum of two Gaussian random vectors which are independent, you should just take the sum of their variations, and then you get that the distributions coincide. Well, it means that if the limiting process exists, then we expect that it should be just the process eta, which is constant at time, which is independent on time, plus some process gamma t, where gamma t has such finite dimensional distributions. Yeah, I mean, this is some formal argument which give us the intuition. So that's why I put this sign here in the convergence. And here, gamma t is a centered Gaussian process with the covariances gamma s equal to, with the same covariances, I made a mistake. This isn't correct here, sorry. Here I have the covariances, in this case I have 1, and here I have 1 half, yeah. So something more unusual that I wrote before. So here you have 1 if the times coincide, yeah, and here you have ti, tj, sorry. And here you have 1 half. And there, this is indeed 1 half if t equals to s, and 0 if t is different from s. So what does it mean? It means that if the limit exists, then it's governed by some very regular process, which is just constant, plus some process which is completely decorrelated in time. So some process which resembles the white noise, but it isn't the white noise, because the white noise somehow has infinite variance, and here the variance is finite. But as well as the white noise, this process isn't defined in the classical sense. That's why in order to understand it rigorously, you should understand it in some weak sense. For example, you should integrate. Then you take the integral from 0 to t of psi tn, and you expect, just integrating this convergence, that this process converges to eta t plus integral from 0 to t of gamma t, gamma s ds. But trying to realize, to find this convergence rigorously, you failed in some sense because of the following proposition, which states that for any function phi which should be just integrable, the function which depends on time, the distribution of the integral from 0 to 1 of phi of s psi sn ds converges weakly to the distribution of eta multiplied by the average of the function phi. What does it mean? It means that, look, if I integrate this relation against the function phi, then indeed here I will have eta times the average of phi, but I should also have the integral phi against the process gamma t, but I do not see this under the limit, and it's clear, in fact, because this process just oscillates too fast because it's completely decorrelated in time, and the oscillations aren't very large because its variance is finite. So under the limit, we do not see it. This proposition, what is remarkable is that we do not need any regularity of the function phi. So indeed, these oscillations are rather powerful. So this proposition gives some information about the limiting behavior of the process xi n, but we lose a lot of information. We do not see at all this process. And our next question is, okay, how can we observe this process under the limit? So to this end, let us, however, consider the integral of our process. And due to this proposition, this integral just vanishes. And but let us look at smaller order terms in this convergence. And this is what exactly we are doing in our theorem. And in fact, we find the influence of this process gamma t in this smaller order terms, which are governed by the centered Gaussian process Zt. So that's why such a statement of the theorem, because I mean we do not want to lose the information. That's why we need to look at the lower order terms. Well, now I hope that I more or less explained the setting. I mean, why do I have such strange setting of the theorem? And now let me say something about its proof. However, to this end, I need to give some preliminary results. More precisely, I will need to generalize this central limit theorem of Kostin and Leibovitz. I have 10 minutes. Ah, okay, that's well. Five. General central limit theorem. So let us note that the number of particles which hits the interval 0, n, which you considered in this central limit theorem, can be represented in the following form. You just take the sum over all particles x, so the sum over x, of the indicator function of the interval 0, 1, of x over n. Indeed, because it's the same that takes the sum of the indicator function of 0, n over x, and then it's clearly the number of particles hitting the interval 0, n. Well, and now let us consider any real measurable function which is bounded and which has a compact support. And then let us replace this indicator function by the function f. And we'll obtain some random variable, which I call sfn, which is the sum over x of f of x over n. And usually such a relation calls the linear statistics, corresponding to the function to the observable f. Okay, and it turns out that the central limit theorem holds not only for such a special choice of the function f, but it holds in general. So theorem 2, the first part. If the variance Sfn grows to infinity, Sn goes to infinity, then we have that the distribution of the random process Sfn minus x expectation over, sorry, not the random process, the random variable over square root of the variance of Sfn just goes to the standard Gaussian. You see, this is indeed just the generalization of this theorem, but for the special observable f, because in this theorem the variance, as we need, grows logarithmically. This theorem was established by Soshnikov under some additional conditions, and it's then generalized to the present form by myself and Sasha. And so the second part of the theorem says the following. It considers a different situation. Let us assume for the moment that the function f is sufficiently regular. So it belongs to the Sobolev class h 1 half plus of r, h 1 half plus, I mean that it's h 1 half plus epsilon for some epsilon. Then, first, it turns out that the variance of the corresponding linear statistics doesn't grow at all. Here, the constant c is independent from n. So we aren't in this setting. And next, the distribution of SFN minus its expectation converges to a normal law with parameters 0, and then you have some variance which you can calculate knowing the function f. It's something like h 1 half norm of the function f, but modified slightly. So you see that the central limit theorem holds without any normalization here, just because the variance does not grow at all. Okay, and now this is what I will need. Now, finally, I will turn to the proof of my theorem. Where will I write it? Okay, I will write it here. Yeah. So it turns out that the theorem can be proven just by applying two times these general versions of standard central limit theorem chosen in an appropriate way. Proof of the theorem 1. Let us put eta n to be equal time integral from 0 to 1 of xi sn ds, and z tn to be equal square root of logarithm of n multiplied by integral from 0 to t xi sn ds minus t eta n. So this is just the choice what I do. And look, and with such choice, we get item 1 automatically. But item 1 itself doesn't say a lot. So what is about the convergence of item 2? So we need to show that eta n jointly with zn converge to eta z. I will not show the joint convergence, but let me show the convergence of two components separately. So first, let us show first the random variable eta n converges weakly to the random variable eta, and where eta is from the theorem, so Gaussian random variable with such parameters, and then that the process that n converges weakly to the process z. And yeah, in fact, the first part, if you remember, the first part follows just from this proposition, because you need to take phi to be equal, just indicator of the interval 0, 1. Yeah, but I didn't prove the proposition, so let me instead prove this convergence honestly. I mean, the proof of the proposition and of this convergence is just the same. And the proof turns out to be simple. We just need to note that, to prove A, that eta n can be represented as Sfn minus the expectation of Sfn over square root of its variance, where the function f, this is just integral from 0 to 1 of the indicator function of interval 0s ds. To get it, you just take the definition of eta n, you take the definition of your random process, where is it, it's here, you insert one to another, and then you also take this relation, you put it there, and you obtain this formula. You calculate, and you find that the variance of Sfn grows to infinity, and more precisely, it behaves like 1 over 2 pi squared logarithm of n. That's why we are in the setting of theorem 2, the first part where the variance grows, so that the central, so this theorem implies the desired convergence. That's it. In order to get the second part, I mean, we argue in the same way. We just know that Ztn equals to Sjtn minus its expectation, where the function Jt, I will not write it precisely, but it's the something of the same spirit. And why do we do not have normalization? Just because of this square root of logarithm to n on which we multiply this relation. And then we apply theorem, the central limit theorem to part 2, and we get the convergence, not the convergence B, because this convergence holds in the space of trajectories, but the convergence of finite dimensional distributions, ztn1 and so on, ztdn for any times t1 td. It converges to the distribution of the random vector zt1 and so on ztd, where this is, and now it turns out to pass from the convergence of finite dimensional distributions to convergence of processes. So somehow we reduce the problem of studying of the functional central limit theorem of irregular statistics which gives us the indicator of the interval 0n, to the studying of the functional central limit theorem of statistics corresponding to the regular observable where the variance does not grow. And it turns out that this investigation is much simpler, and the behavior of trajectories for the case of statistics corresponding to a regular observable is very nice, and in particular they are continuous. Then arguing as when proving the classical functional central limit theorem, for example, for the sum of independent random variables, you get the convergence B. So that's actually the proof of the second part of the theorem. And the third part, you get the rate of convergence you get automatically from the proof of the central limit theorem. So thank you for your attention. Sorry, I'm slightly late.